Of our sin, and give us the liberty of that abundant life Would you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the mystery of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. The first lesson is reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like curtains and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown. Scarcely has their stems who can root in the earth, when he blows up upon them, and they wither, and a tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, or who is my equal? Says he, Holy One. Lift up your eyes on high and see who created these. Who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power. Not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint nor grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us say together our psalm, Psalm 147. We'll say the psalm responsibly. Alleluia. How good it is to sing praise to our God. How blessed it is to honor him with praise. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. Great is our Lord and mighty in power. There is no limit to his wisdom.
The Lord with yourself will be the ground.
Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make music to our God upon the heart.
He covers the heavens with clouds and rivers rain for the earth.
He makes grass to grow upon the mountains and green plants to serve mankind.
He provides food for flocks and herds and for all creations when they rise.
He is not impressed by the might of a horse. He has no pleasure in the strength of a man.
But the Lord has pleasures in those who fear him and those who await his gracious
favor. Alleluia.
Second lesson is a reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, for an obligation is laid on me, and woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I would have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews I became as a Jew, in order to win Jews. To those under the law I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I might by all means save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessings. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to thee, O Lord Christ.
When Jesus and his disciples left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve him. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or were possessed by demons. And the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring town, so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May the words of my lips, the meditations of our hearts, be always acceptable in your sight. O God, our strength and our Redeemer.
Amen.
Oh, well, St. John, it's been a month since I've seen you. Nice to be here. I've got a question for you all. Would you say that in the last, oh, let's say 30 years, things have gotten better or worse?
Worse.
That would be the common answer. There's been a lot of polls about this recently, and people are saying things are worse. Of course, there's a lot of reasons for saying that, right? We can list all kinds of problems. There's also reasons for thinking that things are better. For example, the world poverty rate is lower than it used to be. There are sanitation figures that are better. So there are some problems that are not solved, but less than they used to be. We don't really pay attention to those. I ask you this question, not because there's one particular answer so much, as that I want us to approach this question as Christians. And that is to remember that no matter how you answer, Whether you're saying things are worse or you're saying things are better, we approach it as people of hope, because that's what we are, Christians, people of hope. But our hope is not in the political system or science or psychology or any of that. Of course, our hope is in God, and we need to recognize what that means. That is one of the things the gospel is about. As Jesus does what Jesus does, he is helping us see how we are to live as his followers, or as people with a different way of living in the world. Now, the gospel kind of seems like a laundry list of Jesus things, maybe. And he's doing the sort of things you expect Jesus to do, right? He heals, he casts out demons. The end of the story, he prays. He also proclaims the gospel, or we could say preaching. Pretty normal Jesus things to do, right? You expect that that's what he's going to be doing, and of course he spends a lot of his time doing that. But in his doing those things, we look at the details. It gives us a direction to follow. Let's take, for example, that question I asked you, whether things are better or worse. Now, because of the way things are these days, it gives us the sense that somehow we need to take a stand, right? We need to fight back, fight for what matters, hold on to what matters. And so often as we imagine we are doing that, what we need to do is protect what we have. Set up the boundaries. That's what you'll read in all sorts of advice columns. Set up the boundaries. Make sure people know exactly where you stand. And if they don't listen to you, cut them off. Make sure that you get what you need. And what you have is what is yours. And so as we look in the world, there's all kinds of ways that we build up walls. We set up limits. We divide ourselves. And we do so not because other people are necessarily so terrible, but we can't afford to do differently. How can we possibly care about other people when our own situation is at stake? When we have to have ours. And those other people, they very much are a threat to the way we live. And so, I mean, it's kind of too bad about them, but they really have to get their own act together, right? And whether it's the people from outside our country, whether it is people within our country, whether it's the people we know as neighbors with problems, really, in the end, they got to get their act together, right? Now, it's interesting because in the gospel, Jesus is in a battle too. Did you notice that? It's not quite so obvious, so maybe you don't catch it, but when he's busy casting out demons, you know there's a good guy and a bad guy in that situation, right? And what Jesus is doing, whatever the demons might mean or whatever that looks like, what Jesus is doing is setting that scenario. He has come to oppose whatever it is that stands in the way of God's people being what God has created them to be. And so as he casts out demons, what he's doing is make sure that people can live whole. He frees them. He allows them to be what God has created them to be. He restores them to God's community. He allows them to be part, once again, of society. And keep in mind that all these people who have demons, these are not folks you want to be around. And if Jesus isn't concerned about whether they should belong or not, whether they're likable or not, whether it's their fault or not, any of that, he comes to offer a message of wholeness. He comes to offer a message of hope. And he fights back against all that divides, against all that keeps people from belonging, keeps people from being who they are meant to be. Jesus is fighting a battle. But he's not fighting a battle the way we would have been. It isn't about building up the walls and keeping people out. Jesus is saying that God's presence is in gathering everyone in. And so what Jesus offers is not division, but an invitation. And not a way of splitting people and separating, but a community to which he invites all to belong. And his weapon, his strength, is making it possible for all to belong. If we are going to live in hope, if we are going to show ourselves as God's people, if we're going to follow in Jesus' ways, it's not by building up the barriers. It's not by survival of the fittest and demonstrating that we are the ones who have everything and ignoring the needs and concerns and ways of others. It's not about blaming other people and finding why those folks, for whatever reason, are outside the scope of our compassion. If we're following Jesus, the limits to our compassion aren't there because our hope is in our image as God's people. The truth that Jesus brings, that if we remember we belong to God, if we know that that's our identity, that's our strength, then there is enough to go around. Then as we find ways to care, as we find ways to get out of the way, there is enough. There are ways to find compassion, and that is the hope that we care. Now that's the first step. In Jesus' ministry today, he's casting out demons. You'll also notice that he's healing. Those aren't the same thing, although they sound the same. But when he heals, we have a little vignette of healing. He's bringing people, again, back into the community. But in the story we have today, there's a little bit more detail than that. Did you notice who's healed in the story? It's only a quick little vignette. So Peter's mother is sick, and they go to her house, and Jesus heals her. Now, did you catch what she does as soon as she's healed? She serves. Doesn't that seem kind of rotten? Right? She's just let the poor woman rest, right? Terrible. But we are saying that because we are reading it not with gospel eyes, with eyes that are saying, you know, it really is all about me and my comfort, and that's where I will find my life. But Peter's mother-in-law, interestingly enough, knows better. She knows what Jesus is about. Isn't that interesting that she would serve? Now, what makes service a good thing? Jesus says it's a good thing. Jesus says that he comes as one who serves. Jesus invites his disciples again and again to recognize that the most important disciple is not the one with power and prestige and everybody paying attention, but the important disciple is the one who follows in his footsteps. Steps of service, steps of caring and compassion, of looking out for others and doing what is needed to care for others. That's the disciple he met. In the gospel, the first folks who serve Jesus are an angel. They serve Jesus after he has been tempted in the wilderness, and when that is all done, angels come and serve him. And now, it's Peter's mother-in-law who takes up that angelic task. Somehow, she gets what Jesus is about, that she belongs to the community, that she, in her hosting skills and her ability to offer to others, finds her place, her identity, her connection with Jesus. It's true that his male disciples never really seem to grasp that Jesus comes not to demonstrate how important we are supposed to be, but how we care for others. So is it true? Do we find our life's purpose? We find our place of belonging when we care about other people? Or is our world correct that our life is going to be found when you make everybody else pay attention to you? When you demand your way and you get your way? Recognizing that the world, of course, revolves around me, and it'll all work better if we all recognize that the world revolves around me. You see the difference here that Jesus is offering. The peace The hope that he invites us to embrace is a hope that is found as we follow him in ways of service and compassion, in looking out for others, in understanding others, in taking ourselves out of the center of all of life and putting ourselves where we belong. And that's the last thing that I want to point out in the gospel today, where we belong, the connection, the ultimate connection that we need to make. The gospel today, one of the other things Jesus does is pray. Now that's not a big extraordinary thing, right? I mean, he should pray. He's going to set an example. Prayer's a good thing, right? We all should pray, yes? We're not going to argue about that. Prayer, nothing to say negative about that. But it, in some ways, especially in our world, is really kind of extraordinary. Now, we don't know what Jesus was praying about. We don't know what his words were. We don't know what the ultimate solution or outcome of his prayer was. But what we can say, because what prayer is that as Jesus prays, he's making a connection with God, with that greater reality, with one bigger than us. Now, and you can look this up on Google, not right now, later. Psychology these days is calling this connection with something bigger than ourselves awe, A-W-E. And there is evidence that says as you connect with awe, with the sense that there's something bigger than you, that sense that, of course, we get church, we get prayer, we get in participating in something that's great, you get that sense in nature, the idea of awe, that there is something more than me. That sense gives us, lessens our anxiety, because, of course, we don't have to fix everything. Lessens depression, because it gives us a place of belonging. It is good for our well-being. Now, I'm telling you that not because I want to convince you of the value of prayer. You're here, so you know that, right? I'm telling you this because now when you go out into the world and people are saying, oh yeah, there's something great, you can say, I told you so. Faith is a good thing. Told you so. Come to church. Because we knew this all along. We didn't need psychology to tell us. We knew it all along, and Jesus is demonstrating it now. That if we are going to find our life in this world, whether it's getting better or it's getting worse, we are going to find a place. If we're going to find our sanity, it's going to be in connection with something greater than ourselves. And that something, of course, is our Creator. God who has made us in his image. The God who inspires us to do, to act as his people. And the God, of course, who has given us the way to work, to offer, to be God's people, following in Christ's footsteps. There is no other way. Our wholeness is not found in being ourselves, in outdoing us, in getting our way. Those are the promises of our world. And Jesus comes to be a contrast, to invite us on a different route, to invite us to follow him, saying that this way, not the way of being, not the way of selfishness and self-centeredness, not the way of having all the answers, but the way of recognizing that while we don't have all the answers, we follow the God who does. That while we cannot fix everything, we are called to look to and celebrate and believe in a vision of belonging. And our hope is not in our strength. It's not in how we can avoid or fix problems. Our hope is in the vision that God gives us. The vision of who we are as his people. The vision of who we are created to be, as made in his image, and the vision of how we are inspired to live that out. Now, we won't see the wholeness of that vision in this world. In fact, so much of the time, as I said at the beginning, we tend to see that that vision seems to be being crunched and
destroyed, and we so often don't see what we talk about here. But if we are people of hope, then we look for those places where the truth is seen. We believe in the truth of our connections with one another. And we trust that as we make the sacrifice of our own self-interest, so we will find where we belong. And this, of course, is the journey of the gospel. And this is the hope we are called to share. A hope founded not in us, but in Christ who brings us this message, in Christ who calls us to follow him, and in Christ who gives us the strength to live what he has called us to do. So what do we do about this message? There's so much we could do. And I invite you, of course, to do something. To remember that we are people in prayer. And to take that prayer seriously. To find time of connecting with God. With the mystery that is beyond us. To know that it isn't simply all about us. To find ways to serve. To act in compassion. Find ways to understand, to listen, to connect with others, to let go of our judgments and our demand always be right. So many ways we can do what the gospel calls us to do. But the bottom line is this. If we do what the gospel calls us to do, it is in that, not in our politics, not in our divisions, not in the news or in any of the things that the world offers us. It is in the place of faith that we will find our hope. Our hope that whether things are better or worse, we are not lost. Whether things are better or worse, we know where we belong. And whether things are better or worse, we always have our purpose, our meaning, our call to wholeness, and the freedom to be who we are meant to be, God's people. And it is in that vision that we stand. No better vision, no other hope. And that is what we proclaim. And let us now affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God,
Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in my Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, the Lord of God, the Father, God of God, the light of life, the true God, the true God. We are not made, but we are God. We are all things made. For our salvation, we came from heaven. The power of the Holy Spirit, living in our mind, works here. And let us say, Amen. May you be crucified and washed by the land. We suffer death and suffering. I know you. The day will come again. We will serve the peace. Jesus went through Galilee, preaching and healing and showing compassion for those in need. As God comes to us, comes no less today to those for whom we pray. Let us offer our prayers to God, saying, Lord, in your mercy, hear.
Creator of all, look with favor upon the peoples of the world. In your mercy, give to all people the necessities of a dignified life. Lord, in your mercy, ruler of creation, instill wisdom and understanding among the leaders of nations. Guide them into ways of justice and peace. Lord, in your mercy, Lord of the Church, gather us all into one holy communion. Give us the courage to look to you alone as the source of our unity. Lord, in your mercy. Great physician, bring healing to all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. We pray to those we know and love, and for those known only to you. Inspire us to care for your gifts of healthy bodies and minds. Lord, in your mercy. Spirit of the living Christ, fill us with expectation and eager longing for the coming of that day when no one will suffer, but when all will be gathered together in heavenly joy and eternal prosperity. Lord, in your mercy. Here you may add your own intercessions, either aloud or in silence.
People of Ukraine and the Middle East.
Amen.
Teresa, Anne, and Allison.
Amen.
Brother Solomon, Lisa.
Amen.
Continued healing for Ken.
Amen.
For Alice.
Amen. For David and Jerry.
Amen. For Michael and Valerie and Kiana.
Amen.
For John.
Amen.
For Christopher and Carly, Eddie and y'all.
Amen.
All this we ask, O God, in the name of Christ, who died and rose for us, and whose coming in glory we await. Thank our prayers and praises through Christ our Lord. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We have to be sorry and humbly repent. We wish to be your Son, Jesus Christ, and pursue on the sin and forgive us, that we may live life in your will.
And walk in your face. God, have mercy on you, forgive you of your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
It's the Lord be all. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name, bring offerings, and come into his court.
It's been talking about you, but I think we all know. Oh, the Lord is present, and we have standing on holy ground. Lord, Your truth is heaven, and so is heaven, our holy heaven. Your truth is heaven, and so is heaven, our holy. In
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. When we have fallen into sin, become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy said to Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, you share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, God and Father of all, he stretched out his arm on the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, he gave it to his disciples, and said, take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. He took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, drink this, all of you. This is my blood, new covenant, which you shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink, do this for the remembrance of me. Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit. Be for your people, the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All of us we ask, your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray.
Father,
Passover is sacrificed for us.
God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your heart. Faith with thanksgiving.
We're gonna stand in front of that.
Thank you.
Christ, the Son of God, be to you, that your lives may be a light to the world. Blessed be God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Please be seated as we hear about the life of the church. But first, let's have prayer and blessing. Should we have birthdays, anniversaries? Thank you. God, you have taught us through your blessed Son that whoever receives a little child in the name of Christ receives Christ himself. We give you thanks for the blessing you have bestowed upon this family, giving them a child. Confer their joy by a lively sense of your presence with them. Give them calm strength and patient wisdom as they seek to bring this child to love all that is true and noble, just and pure, lovable and gracious, excellent and admirable, following the example of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Do we have any information about the life of the church that we want to share? Good. Yes.
Hi, everyone. I'm Marty, slightly taller than Calvin. And we're calling this Comfort Sunday. There's in the in Bennington Hall. There is a carnivore version and a vegetarian version. They're both pretty good. And Also, we have a lot coming up. Can you go back there, take a look at the sign-up sheets, because there's seven. So we have, next week we have the Valentine's Super Bowl mashup. And guys, come on, you can come and just sign up, sign your name, bring a football or Valentine-themed food, or throw them together and make it all fun. Parker can do it, okay? And it'll be fun. So you can just have some fun. The February sign-up sheet is up there. And soup suppers. We have five coming up. And they start Tuesday in 2 weeks.
13.
The 13th is Ash Wednesday. 8 start
after
8:30.
It's
20th. I could have looked at the date that I put on the sign. So anyway, soup suppers. Please sign up. We need soups, vegetarian, and meat, and bread, rolls, cheese, fruit, salads, whatever you want to bring. And it's a good time. So it's Tuesday nights at 6. Thank you. Dale, you're up.
Any other? Oh, yes.
Thank you. Just want to remind everybody about the Holy Happy Hour Bible Study. Tuesday evening on Zoom, 7 p.m. All you need to do is go to the News and the Pews and find a place to click on it. Click on it, you'll take you right in. And I would say we are going through Mark right now, having some really, really good conversations with regard to the Gospel of Mark. But it is such a treat to be able to go through these things. We may be able to spend maybe 10 minutes on a subject such as preached about today, but to have someone come forward and week by week and expound on these things that we have studied only briefly, it's a wonderful thing, and I would certainly encourage you to participate. And if you don't even want to participate, you can go on there and you can look at the video from the time before and enjoy yourself that way. Okay, so thank you so much. And hope to see you there.
Let us conclude our worship then, Ben, and we'll sing our last hymn.
Hallelujah.